Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Spotify Play, how CEO and founder Daniel Ek beat Apple, Google, and Amazon in the race for audio dominance, by Sven Carlsson and Jonas Leijonhufvud. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Prologue. Toward the end of 2010, Spotify had spent 2 years amassing 7 million users in Europe. But the company's crucial U.S. launch faced massive delays. Founder and CEO Daniel Ek was struggling to understand why. He called and breathed down the line, he told one of his staff members, who would later recount the conversation. Who? The colleague said. Steve Jobs, Daniel replied. Daniel's colleague wondered if his boss was serious. What do you mean? He didn't say anything? How do you know it's him? I know that it was him, Daniel said. After years of frustrating negotiations with the major record labels, Spotify's founder was beginning to understand who truly called the shots in the music industry. Apple's resistance to Daniel's free music streaming was becoming clear, and it was starting to burden him. The industry power dynamics at play weighed heavily on his mind as he walked to Spotify's headquarters in Stockholm and on his many flights to New York, London, and Los Angeles. The long shadow of Steve Jobs had towered over Spotify since the startup was founded in 2006. At that point, Apple was already the world's largest platform for digital music distribution, with iTunes and the iPod music player working hand in glove. Now, 7 years after the launch of the iTunes Store, Apple's grip was even firmer. While Daniel Ek was fretting over iTunes in Stockholm, Steve Jobs was in Cupertino, California, obsessing over his own arch-rival. The iPhone had become a huge success after launching in 2007. But 3 years later, his iconic product was under siege from a growing fleet of Android smartphones powered by Google. To Steve Jobs, music was a crucial weapon in a holy war against the search giant and its operating system. The iTunes model, based on downloads for 99 cents per song, worked on any Apple device and on PCs. But Android phones were not part of the iTunes ecosystem, and Steve Jobs liked it that way. He had spent years building Apple's lucrative walled garden. And he would be damned if one of his key competitive advantages, easily accessible music, was compromised by some upstart from Europe streaming music for pennies on the dollar. In this context, Spotify was a threat. The Swedish service was catching on in several European countries, and had created a lot of buzz in the U.S. Spotify had the potential to become a major challenger on Apple's home turf. What if the startup was acquired by Microsoft, or even worse, Google? For Daniel, access to the U.S. was a matter of survival. After more than 4 years of growth and constant label negotiations, he was so close to being the world's largest music market that he could almost taste it. By now, the 27-year-old Swede had powerful allies in the music industry. He had earned the support of Sean Parker, Napster's outspoken co-founder, and he was on a first-name basis with Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg, who had promised to help Spotify with their launch. Daniel had even lined up a deal with Universal Music, the label with the closest personal ties to Steve Jobs. But suddenly, Universal's executives refused to sign. The machine ground to a halt, and Spotify's investors were becoming nervous. In fact, Spotify would soon start to see negative user growth for the first time. It could all come crashing down. Perhaps Daniel's only option was to talk directly with Steve Jobs. According to several sources, however, the Spotify CEO never got to meet his counterpart in Cupertino. Despite his failing health, Steve Jobs continued to fight for his vision. He aimed to shift iTunes over to the cloud, and he wasn't afraid to badmouth Spotify and ad-funded music streaming to any label executive who would listen. As this book will show, many of them did. At Spotify's headquarters, the air was thick with tension in late 2010. Their launch in the U.S. kept meeting delays that nobody could explain. The company's top brass whispered about the bosses at Apple, Universal, Warner, and Sony, but only a few select people had any firm details. Daniel's colleague would never find out if it really was Steve Jobs who made that fateful phone call. The Spotify CEO was, after all, known to sometimes tell stories that were hard to verify. What happened in the following years now belongs to history. Since launching in Sweden in 2008, Spotify can rightfully claim to have saved the record labels from piracy, returned the music industry to growth, and forced Apple, a tech industry behemoth, to change its business model. While Steve Jobs broke the album down into tracks and playlists, Daniel Ek popularized the freemium subscription model and laid the groundwork for a new era of playlist by algorithm. With a market cap in the tens of billions on Wall Street, Spotify is the largest music streaming company in the world, with more than 50 million songs, over a million podcasts, business in more than 90 countries, and a user base expected to surpass 350 million in 2021. Nearly half of its users now pay for the ad-free version, making the platform the industry's most important source of revenue, with billions of dollars delivered every year. But what really happened during the company's spectacular journey to the top? The Spotify Play is an unofficial corporate biography detailing how a secretive startup from the Stockholm suburb of Roegsved revolutionized music distribution. As Swedish business journalists, the two of us have met and interviewed Daniel Ek and his co-founder, Martin Lorentzon, several times over the years. They have, however, declined to partake in any exclusive interviews for this book. But in August 2018, as we were writing the Swedish edition of the Spotify Play, we were among the journalists invited to Spotify's new state-of-the-art headquarters in Stockholm. During a brief question-and-answer session, we asked Daniel Ek to name the single most important reason for his company's success. "I'll give you two reasons," he replied. "First of all, we were committed to the freemium business model when no one else was. This was very controversial. Second, we started in Sweden, proved our model, opened up in more European countries, and grew organically one country at a time. That's what finally made the music industry realize that our model was the future." Daniel Ek has been reluctant to tell the full Spotify story. He has talked about certain aspects in the press while carefully guarding the rest. So, to put this book together, we interviewed more than 80 sources, some on the record, some on background, who have been along for the journey. Many of those we asked declined out of a sense of allegiance. Others felt compelled to contribute despite their loyalties. Some of our interviewees have served as executives at Spotify. Others have been board members, investors, or music industry decision makers. A few are direct competitors. We have also relied on mountains of documents, some public, such as annual reports, and some confidential. We have pored over the interviews and public appearances that many other Spotify employees have made over the years. The Spotify Play is a story of how strong convictions, unrelenting will, and big dreams can help small players take on tech titans and change an industry forever. Sven Carlsson and Jonas Leijonhufvud, Fåglarö, Stockholm, August 2020. Chapter 1. A Secret Idea. In the fall of 2005, Daniel Ek passed through Vasastan in central Stockholm. His thoughts were brimming with an idea for a new company. He had a plan and a potential partner, but the timing still wasn't right. What he needed right now was a job and an income. The past few years had taken their toll on him. He had been working full-time since he graduated from high school. His was a world where new ideas sprung up all the time, and the work never really stopped. Daniel's hustle included formal roles at tech companies, where he would get paid to apply his skills in online advertising and search engine optimization, but he was also constantly developing other ideas, putting small teams to work on projects that he would often fund himself. It was a taxing lifestyle. His hair was thinning, his clothes were unkempt, and he looked older than his 22 years. But none of that mattered much to him. He was a man with big ideas and a mind fixated firmly on the future. Daniel walked down Tegnérgatan until he arrived at the site of his job interview, a pub called Man in the Moon. It was furnished in a British style, with dark wood paneling lining the walls and sofas covered in green leather upholstery. After a moment, he fixed his gaze on a bespectacled man in his late 30s who waved him forward. Matthias Miksha was dressed like your average tech entrepreneur, t-shirt and suit jacket. He had just become CEO of Stardoll, a website full of virtual paper dolls that catered to young girls. Stardoll had new investors and the site's user growth was impressive. Now Miksha needed to recruit staff, rebuild the back end, and scale up the company for the international market. The two shook hands and sat down. At first, the low-key Daniel Eck didn't make much of an impression. But as the conversation unfolded, Matthias Miksha felt the young man growing in confidence. The disheveled 22-year-old offered a variety of interesting thoughts on where the industry was heading. "I'd like you to be our new CTO," Matthias Miksha said at last. Daniel was ready and willing, but he wanted to join only as a consultant, not as a full-time employee. "I have another thing that I'll need to take care of," he explained. Matthias Miksha accepted, and the meeting ended with a handshake. Light My Fire. To manifest his secret idea, Daniel Eck knew he needed a partner. He had recently met Martin Lorentzon, a 36-year-old entrepreneur with a crooked grin and slicked back hair. Lorentzon had moved to Stockholm from the textile city of Borås near Sweden's west coast in the late 90s and elbowed his way through the capital's resurging tech scene. And if everything went as planned, he would soon be a very wealthy man. When the tech bubble burst in March 2000, things had turned sour for nearly the entire industry. Martin, however, had been lucky enough to build a company in one of the few corners of the sector that survived the crash and thrived in the years that followed. With his partner, Felix Hagner, he had founded an affiliate marketing company called Trade Doubler, which offered a partially automated system for banner placement, in which advertisers paid for results rather than exposure. The company had taken off since its inception in 1999 and was now, near the end of 2005, poised for an initial public offering on the Stockholm Stock Exchange. When the two first met, Daniel was only 3 years out of high school, but he already had a good deal of experience in Sweden's fledgling online advertising business. In a recent side project, he had gathered a few programmers to create a new service he called AdVertigo. The system was said to know what advertisement best fit a given space online. Advertisers could opt to pay only when the ad generated the phone number of a potential customer. With the economy rebounding, Daniel was seeking new opportunities, which led him to Trade Doubler's head office on Norra Bantorget in Stockholm and into Martin's orbit. The pair first met in summer 2005 when Daniel tried to pitch Trade Doubler on a product search engine akin to Google's Frugal, later redubbed Google Product Search. According to his own retelling, Martin wasn't very impressed, but the two of them stayed in touch. Not long after, Daniel organized a game of Counter-Strike between his employer, the search engine optimization firm Yaja, and Trade Doubler. Daniel's team won the challenge handily, making a strong impression on Martin. Years later, he found out that Daniel had secretly enlisted the help of several professional gamers from the renowned Swedish Counter-Strike team, Ninjas in Pajamas, in order to win. Martin had no formal title at Trade Doubler. Instead, he took the role of an omnipresent founder, boosting the morale of his employees and troubleshooting various challenges. One former colleague would later describe him as the company's flying goalkeeper, using a metaphor from two of Sweden's favorite pastime sports, soccer and ice hockey. Martin had a brash, competitive spirit about him. Unwilling to be pinned down by specific responsibilities, he was ready to assist as negotiator, salesperson, problem solver, and cheerleader. Now, in the fall of 2005, his main goal was to take Trade Doubler public. After nearly 7 years with the company, he was ready to sell off his shares and move on to something new. Despite an age difference of almost 14 years, Daniel and Martin hit it off. They found common ground discussing search engines, metadata, and how to generate large amounts of online traffic to sell advertising. More importantly, they bonded over the potential of peer-to-peer technology, in which files are distributed directly between users' own hard drives without needing to transfer through a central server. The soon-to-be partners also had several friends in common. One was Jacob DeGeer, a social acquaintance of Daniel and one of Trade Doubler's first employees. Much later, Jacob DeGeer would make hundreds of millions of dollars by selling his payments company, iZettle, to PayPal. In the fall, Daniel Ek and Martin Lorentzson began meeting regularly to discuss business ideas. Slowly, Daniel opened up about how he wanted to merge peer-to-peer technology with commercial content. Martin liked what he heard and seemed eager to give it a shot. But first, he had to list his company and sell off a large portion of his shares. True Colors. A month or so after his job interview at Vasastan, Daniel Ek started to work as Chief Technology Officer, CTO, at Stardoll. He quickly recruited several programmers out of his own network, and the team started to rebuild the website from scratch. Colleagues found Daniel to be an introvert who avoided conflicts. He never wore a button-down shirt, preferring instead jeans and yesterday's t-shirt. He'd often forget to clean up after himself. Once, allegedly, a sign proclaiming that Daniel Ek's mom doesn't work here appeared in the office kitchen. Soon it disappeared, without any mention from Daniel. After a few weeks, however, the 22-year-old's co-workers began to see how gifted he was. Matthias Miksha delighted at Daniel's progression and at his own recruitment of the new CTO. As the weeks wore on, Daniel ensured that traffic to the website was through the roof, and when his shyness gave way, he could be both funny and fascinating. Stardoll.com became one of the internet's biggest playgrounds for girls between the ages of 10 and 17. The website suddenly had millions of weekly users and was raking in cash by selling virtual clothing and accessories. Matthias Miksha now ran one of the hottest startups in Stockholm. He started recruiting the best engineering students in town, fresh out of the KTH Royal Institute of Technology, widely recognized as the MIT of Sweden. He also secured $10 million in financing from two of the world's leading venture capital firms, Index Ventures in London and Sequoia Capital in Silicon Valley. Despite this success, Daniel was committed to leaving Stardoll as soon as he could. His head and heart were in getting his own company on its feet. He also considered taking some of his colleagues with him on his new adventure. One candidate was a 27-year-old development director named Henrik Torstensson. Another was the company's artistic director, Christian Wilson, a tall and lanky guy with a dry sense of humor. But above all, Daniel wanted to recruit Andreas Ayen, a phenomenal programmer with sideswept bangs who dressed in carefully ironed shirts. Andreas had attended the private prep school Tyska Skolan in Stockholm, spoke with a posh accent, and had a worldly air about him. He'd recently interned at the software company BEA Systems in Silicon Valley as part of his final year at the KTH Royal Institute of Technology. He never completed his degree, opting instead to work at Stardoll. When Daniel opened up about his side project, the ambitious Andreas Ayen was more than a little curious. Paradise City. On November 8, 2005, Trade Doubler was listed on the Stockholm Stock Exchange. Martin Lorentzon was now able to sell a large portion of his shares for nearly $12 million. Felix Hogner, who owned approximately twice as much of the company, raked in even more. The two founders were now in the public eye. They gave an interview with the Swedish business paper Dagens Industri and posed for photographs in Trade Doubler's office and in the Norra Bontoriet Square. In the photos, Martin is dressed in a pinstripe suit and a striped shirt. He holds a Sony Ericsson P910i cell phone in one hand and the stylus used to navigate the screen in the other. Trade Doubler's founders were quick to transfer their newfound wealth to Cyprus, where they had registered holding companies 2 months earlier. A few weeks after Trade Doubler went public, Daniel Ek established a holding company in the tax haven as well, likely with Martin's help. Martin dubbed his company Rosello Company Limited. Daniel's company was named Instructus Limited. By 2005, Martin and Daniel were ready to invest in a new project together. There was just one snag. Per the usual initial public offering, IPO restrictions, the Trade Doubler founders' shares were locked up, meaning they couldn't sell all of their holdings immediately. Both Martin and Felix had to wait at least 6 more months. After that, the plan was to sell and reinvest in Martin and Daniel's new venture. Feeling hot, hot, hot. In early 2006, Martin Lorentzon and Daniel Ek met frequently outside of work. Martin, now a multimillionaire, would take the green subway line to the gray suburb of Roegsved to visit his protege. Daniel still lived in the apartment he grew up in, part of a three-story building atop a hill on Stuvargatan, a few blocks from Roegsved's subway station. His mother, Elisabeth, and his stepfather, Hasse, had moved out, but were still registered at the address. 100 yards away, a few concrete high-rise apartment buildings shot up toward the sky. In Martin's eyes, the rundown suburb would have contrasted sharply with the lush suburban area of Borås, where he'd grown up in the 1970s. The duo bonded by watching movies. At one point, ahead of Martin traveling out to Roegsved, Daniel jokingly gave him the same advice that Michael Corleone gives Enzo the Baker in the first film of the Godfather trilogy. Put your hand in your pocket like you have a gun. Daniel's apartment in Roegsved quickly became an impromptu workshop. Servers hummed in the closet, downloading countless pirated files at all hours of the day, warming the apartment to tropical levels. As they spitballed business ideas, Daniel and Martin would sometimes sit in front of their computers wearing nothing but underwear. They had now agreed to start a company, but Daniel still wasn't sure he could count on Martin's financial investment. He wondered what the next step was. "I'll put in 10 million crowns," Martin said at one point. Daniel would later describe how he checked his bank account the next day and found the money, a sum worth more than $1 million, sitting there. Martin's decisiveness and dedication must have excited the 23-year-old computer whiz. They would later tell the story of them sitting in Daniel's apartment, calling out words in the hope of naming their company something great that wasn't already taken. Martin thought he heard Daniel call out Spotify from another room. He typed Spotify.com into his browser and nothing came up. He proceeded to purchase the domain name all over the world. Daniel, however, would maintain that Martin must have misheard him. He doesn't remember saying Spotify. Poker Face. As winter gave way to spring, Daniel Eck frequently had lunch with his Stardoll colleague Andreas Ayen. The young programmer had quickly taken on an informal leadership role at the company and looked like Daniel's natural successor as CTO. During these informal chats, the pair talked about new business opportunities and the future of technology. Gradually, Daniel opened up about his other projects. He wouldn't say exactly what he was up to, but Andreas would recall how Daniel enjoyed discussing the possibilities of BitTorrent, a type of peer-to-peer technology which broke files down into smaller pieces and sent them between computers in a network and then reassembled them on arrival. The technology allowed fast transfers, even over networks with lower bandwidth, and had been made popular by the Pirate Bay, the infamous Swedish file-sharing website. In essence, Daniel wanted to do something similar to the Pirate Bay, but legally. During that spring of 06, Daniel revealed more details to Andreas, at one point proclaiming that it should be possible to build an ad-funded streaming service for video, music, and other media. Around the same time, Daniel gave his colleague Christian Wilson two small freelance assignments. One was to construct a graphic profile for his side project, AdVertigo. Daniel mentioned that he was going to show the product to a representative from Google, with whom he had scheduled a meeting at Arlanda Airport north of Stockholm, as one source would recall. The second assignment was to create a logo for a new company that had something to do with streaming. Daniel told Wilson that he was tossing the idea around with someone else, but he didn't say whom. It's important that the logo is Web 2.0, Daniel explained. When Christian Wilson created Spotify's first logo, he was inspired by the graphic profile of Skype, the voice-over internet company founded by the Swede Niklas Zennström and the Dane Janos Friis in 2003. He used the same type of bubbly, playful font and added three wavy lines above the O in Spotify to illustrate streaming. In a couple of days, he'd created Spotify's first light green logo with the wavy lines that would later become its app icon. He invoiced Daniel $770 for his work. In late March 2006, Daniel Eck sold AdVertigo to Trade Doubler for $1.3 million. The company had no income and basically consisted of some advertising technology and a few tech consultants. AdVertigo's services would have little impact on Trade Doubler's operations, according to several executives serving at the time. Then again, the purchase price was small compared to Trade Doubler's market cap of around $360 million. The deal hardly made a blip on anyone's radar. For Daniel, however, the windfall was more than welcome. Within a matter of weeks, he and Martin Lorentzon would sign the paperwork and start their new company together. Spotify was still in its conceptual stage, but Daniel now had his own funds to kickstart the project. In the coming months, he moved from his rundown apartment in Roegsved to a condo on Hagagatan in Vasastan, not far from Martin's place in central Stockholm. There, he furnished a home office, installed a massive TV in the living room, and equipped his new digs with the latest home technology. He also left Stardoll to dedicate all his time to his new company. In later interviews, Daniel would describe a period of partying in which he, newly rich, bought a Ferrari sports car and hung out at the nightclubs around Stockholm's central business district of Stureplan. But the girls he wanted to impress turned out to be fake and shallow. The adventure ended with Daniel isolating himself in a house in the countryside close to his mom, strumming his guitar. As he came out of his depression, he decided to dedicate his life to Spotify, a company that married his love for technology with his love for music. The timing of this is unclear. More than a decade later, Swedish motor vehicle records contained no trace of a Ferrari, though an agency representative admitted that their historical data was sometimes spotty. Perhaps Daniel's origin story should not be interpreted literally. Many people who know him attest to his tendency, particularly in his early years, to embellish and add spice to his stories. As a young man, two people would recall, he earned the nickname Spicer, or Kridan in Swedish, among some of his close friends. Good Vibrations. According to Martin Lorentzen's official story, Spotify was founded on his 37th birthday on April 1, 2006. The paperwork was filed a couple of weeks later. For a brief period, the Swedish company, Spotify AB, acted as Spotify's parent company. It was, in turn, owned by Martin and Daniel's holding companies on Cyprus. With the AdVertigo deal behind them, and the paperwork complete, the pieces quickly fell into place. On May 3rd, Trade Doubler announced that Martin had sold half of his remaining shares in the company for almost $11 million. Felix Hagner had sold shares worth twice that. To calm the market, the founders promised not to sell any more shares for the next 6 months. The stock price took a hit, but would soon bounce back and climb to new heights. Between them, Trade Doubler's founders had now amassed around $70 million. At about the same time, Daniel Leck went to see his successor at Stardoll, Andreas Ayen, to make him an offer. "We're starting a company. You want in?" he said. Andreas didn't need much time to decide. Pioneering the international market for virtual paper dolls was not a bad gig for an engineer in his early 20s, but here was an irresistible opportunity. He soon became Spotify's first CTO, with enough stock options to eventually make him independently wealthy. Andreas Ayen's departure from Stardoll was a blow to its CEO, Matthias Miksha. In the years to come, he would find himself in an uphill battle with Daniel and Andreas for Stockholm's top programming talent. Stardoll was no longer the hottest startup in town. Chapter 2. The Engineers. Daniel Ek and Andreas Ayen spent much of the summer of 2006 recruiting the best engineers around. Daniel attracted some of the consultants who had helped him at Stardoll. Andreas proved invaluable in drawing engineers from KTH, where he'd earned a reputation as one of the brightest students in his graduating class. In August, a small group of engineers flew to Barcelona for Spotify's kickoff. Over tapas and red wine, Daniel and Martin Lorentzen explained that they wanted to create a legal torrent-based platform for the distribution of music and possibly video. The service would be ad-funded but free to use, they explained, because that was the only way to fight piracy. They also made it clear that developing the product would be their top priority. Commercial licenses and agreements could wait. Fortunately, the gang in Barcelona didn't grasp how difficult those final challenges would prove to be. If they had, they may never have attempted to build the platform. In the era of Kazaa and the Pirate Bay, the word free caused record label executives' eyes to roll, their heads to shake, and their doors to close. Spotify's founders had never negotiated licenses before. They had no idea how strongly the industry would resist their attempt to build an ad-based streaming service by employing the same technology that was being used for illegal file sharing. Yet the gang munching tapas on the coast of Catalonia had at least three things going for it: Martin's experience and considerable wealth, Daniel's clear and unwavering vision of a product, and Andreas's ability to attract and inspire Sweden's best programmers. In the fall of 2006, the Spotify engineers moved into the company's first office. It was located on the second floor of an apartment building on Riddargatan, where Stockholm's central business district meets the posh residential area of Östermalm. Here, the Spotify crew spent their first week lugging IKEA flat packs up the stairs and assembling office furniture. They unpacked whiteboards and installed computers and servers. It was a humbling task, literally building a company from scratch. No one could know that the work they'd started would, over time, turn hundreds of Spotify employees into millionaires. You're the one that I want. The king of torrent technology at this time was a Swede named Ludvig Strigius. He was a self-taught 25-year-old hacker who had single-handedly built MicroTorrent, one of the world's most popular file-sharing clients. The ultralight program was used to download files rapidly from file websites such as the Pirate Bay. Early on, Daniel Ek and Martin Lorentzon realized that Luda, as he was called, could be key to Spotify's success. Martin had set up a meeting through an acquaintance named Niklas Ivarsson, a charismatic engineer from Borås and head of the European division of ATI, a company that sold software to the automotive industry. He had worked with Luda and was blown away by the young programmer's talent for analyzing code and quickly building his own programs. Ludvig Strigius was the kind of genius who, as a child, would spend time disassembling household appliances to see how they worked. His mother told a story of how, in kindergarten, he was able to fix a broken dishwasher before the repairman showed up. But the young Luda also suffered from a tragic medical condition. As a toddler, his parents had noticed that something wasn't quite right with his hips. The doctors determined that he had spinal muscular atrophy, an incurable disease that breaks down the body over time. By the time Luda was 8 years old, he was confined to a wheelchair. Luda's first computer was a Commodore VIC-20. He later inherited a PC, learned to code in BASIC, and began creating simple programs and games. In his teens, he became a hacker and, quite famously, cloned Scum, a popular gaming engine used to build computer games in the late 1980s. Scum ran on protected source code, which stopped most young coders from looking under the hood. But Luda was able to analyze the underlying assembler code, which had passed through a compiler and been translated to a language that only computer processors could understand. Line by line, he deciphered the code and translated the information back into a human programming language. It took him several years, but in the end, Luda had built something he called Scum VM. Its users could now convert Scum games into any desired operating system. Luda then released his clone as open source code so that anyone could contribute. It was a remarkable feat of programming, especially for a teenager. Luda's youthful antics made him a phenomenal and unconventional programmer. He preferred to code in C++, an older language that was considerably more difficult than popular alternatives like Java and C#. But when used properly, C++ resulted in fast and lightweight programs. In 2005, when Luda released MicroTorrent, the entire file weighed only 50 kilobytes, approximately half as much as a low-resolution photograph. It was the kind of stuff that turns hackers into legends. Daniel Ek and Martin Lorentzon began to woo Ludvig Strigius in the summer of 2006. They traveled to ATI's offices in the Gårda business district of Gothenburg, where Niklas Ivarsson made the introduction. The two founders explained that Spotify's system would be based on BitTorrent technology. They needed his help to build it, and they were willing to buy MicroTorrent in order to recruit him. They were proposing an acqui-hire long before the term became widely used in the tech world. Luda thought the idea sounded cool enough, but he was hesitant. Spotify's offer was low on cash, and he already had two American suitors. One was BitTorrent Inc., founded by the program legend Bram Cohen, who had authored the original Protocol. The other was Azurius, who had a competing BitTorrent client that was popular, but not as fast as the one Luda had built. Can't Buy Me Love. By the early fall of 2006, Ludwig Strigius felt overwhelmed by his options. Should he sell MicroTorrent to Spotify and start working there, or accept one of his American offers? The people from Azurius had already flown into Gothenburg to wine and dine him at the elite hotel. Representatives from BitTorrent Inc. had gifted him a trip to the film festival in Cannes, all expenses paid. All three of his bidders seemed impatient. The problem was too much for Luda's analytical mind. There were too many unknown variables. Azurius sent a contract full of American legalese that Luda struggled to comprehend. The ramifications of selling his company to a U.S. operation were making him nervous. After all, his program was being used for illegal downloading. Just a few months earlier, the Pirate Bay had been the target of a police raid in Sweden. What if he too was sued? All things considered, Luda decided to accept the offer from Spotify. It felt reassuring to work for a Swedish company close to his colleagues. In mid-October 2006, Spotify finalized the deal with MicroTorrent. At the same time, Niklas Iversson left ATI to join Spotify. He would soon prove an asset in the difficult negotiations with the record labels. Spotify paid Ludwig Strigius a small amount of cash and enough shares to make him Spotify's fourth largest shareholder. Martin Lorentzon, 42.8%, Daniel Ek, 42.8%, Felix Hagner, 9.5%, Ludwig Strigius, 4.9%. A few weeks after the deal, Spotify sold MicroTorrent to BitTorrent Inc. Over the years, Luda's shares would be diluted as new investors came on board, but his stake was large enough to be valued in the hundreds of millions of dollars by the time Spotify went public. Indestructible. From the start, Daniel Ek knew what he expected of his CTO, Andreas Ayen. Spotify's client needed to be quick and nimble. There was no room for the types of glitches often found in other media players on the market. The music needed to flow like water from a faucet. Delays due to buffering would not be tolerated at Spotify. It's not cool to have to wait, as an early version of the Spotify.com website put it. The plan was to base the system on BitTorrent technology. The users would download the Spotify client and offload its own servers by storing parts of the songs on their own hard drives, sharing them with other users in the network. The arrangement would speed up the system and outsource some of Spotify's broadband expenses. Unlike the Pirate Bay, Spotify intended to share a part of its advertising revenue with artists and record companies. But the founders clearly felt their users shouldn't have to pay for music. Our service is ad-funded, so it costs you nothing to use, the website stated, long before the service had been launched. Programming chops were paramount to Andreas as he expanded his team. He made one key recruitment in October 2006 when he called Frederick Niemöller, a 27-year-old doctoral student at KTH, and offered him a job. Frederick was a soft-spoken computer scientist from Norrland in the north of Sweden. He sported a ponytail and goatee and had been captain of a coding team at KTH that would soon win a world championship in programming. Frederick Niemöller would recall how Andreas, over dinner in Stockholm's bourgeois district of Vasastan, painted a grand vision of Spotify's future. The goal was to build an agnostic streaming platform, Andreas explained. Music was just the first step. After that, Spotify would expand into streaming television, film, and more. They were building a company, sure, but the product would be technically sophisticated and ideologically akin to the file-sharing movement. The Spotify CTO made a profound first impression on Frederick, who was immediately drawn in by the prospect of applying his knowledge to solve a contemporary problem. After all, the battle between young file sharers and record companies was on everyone's lips. Frederick also had a great deal of respect for many of the other engineers who had left KTH to join Spotify. To start, Frederick agreed to take on a part-time role as technical advisor. A few months later, he started working full-time. Soon, he was staying at work late into the night. Eventually, he would stay behind until the early morning, taking cabs back to his apartment in the suburb of Rinkeby. A few hours later, he would wake up, take the subway back into the city, and start over. Daniel Eck tracked his progress and figured Frederick Niemöller would soon be due for a promotion. We are family. The office on Riddargatan quickly became a second home for the young engineers building Spotify's desktop client. Many of them were in their mid-20s working their first real job. They would show up late in the morning but work long hours. The staffers had squeezed a foosball table into the office, and some would stay behind for some late-night poker, too. The guys working on the back-end technology had camped out in the apartment's largest room, past the closet with the humming servers. Floral-patterned curtains hung over the windows, right next to a whiteboard that Andreas Ayen presided over. Frederick Niemöller had quickly become his right-hand man, primarily dedicated to building the streaming technology. Others were occupied with the database or the advertising platform. A programmer named Magnus Hult was in charge of all the metadata that threaded together songs, artists, and album art. The team would organize Spotify's music database like books in a library. Users would be able to search by artist or song and discover other music by the same artist. They could also find cover songs, guest appearances, and songs by the same producer. Later, Spotify would pay for short biographical texts and become a sort of encyclopedia for music. Eventually, the company would develop algorithms that made recommendations, pushing music by Rihanna on Beyoncé fans. There was a smaller room for those working on the front end of the client. This was the domain of Ludwig Strigius, who built the user interface for Windows and then for Mac, all by himself. Luda worked out of Gothenburg but made regular visits to the team in Stockholm. He worked closely with Rasmus Andersson, a designer who would touch up his work and create Spotify's graphic design. A third room housed the rest of the Spotify team. That included Petr Hansson, Spotify's general counsel, and Daniel Eck when he wasn't out negotiating licenses with the record labels. In February 2007, they were joined by Jonathan Forster, Spotify's first director of sales. He soon realized that his job wouldn't be easy, complaining that clients didn't see the value of targeted ads. "You can't sell steak to people who want ground beef," the Brit would tell his colleagues. It fell on Martin Lorentzen to deal with investors and venture capital firms. On a regular day, he would hit the gym and go out for lunch with a business acquaintance. Now and then, he would drop by the office and crack jokes with the engineers. "What's up, slackers?" he'd say teasingly. The programmers chuckled. They knew he was up to something important, but not exactly what. Then again, he didn't really have a clear grasp of what they were up to either. Martin would set the tone for a culture of pranks and practical jokes around the office. He would later describe how employees slipped inappropriate magazines into one another's bags or entered fake status updates on one another's Facebook pages. At one point during an early pitch at a venture capital firm in the U.S., Lorentzen recalled opening his laptop and unleashing a pre-installed program that performed a Google search for the term "How to enlarge a small penis." The prank, initiated by an employee, caught Daniel off guard, and the pitch ended up failing. Slice me nice. Spotify's engineers were now forging ahead to build a first-class product. Daniel Ek had insisted that users should be able to find a song instantly and play it without delay. Soon all the technical discussions revolved around latency, which had a number, 200 milliseconds. Frederick Niemöller had read that if a song started playing within 0.2 seconds of a button being pushed, people would experience it as immediate. The bandwidth in Sweden's broadband networks was already good enough for songs to load faster than they were being played. So, in theory, it should be possible to start playing a song while it was still loading. The challenge with BitTorrent was that the files were broken down into pieces that arrived in a torrent, so in no particular order. Forcing the protocol to change this would slow the process down. As Andreas Ayen's team worked on solving this challenge, his back-end team turned their office into a war room. For weeks, engineers scribbled on the whiteboard, vigorously debating how the BitTorrent technology could be repurposed to suit their needs. Finally, one of the sketches seemed to make sense. The solution even looked elegant. One illustration showed how the existing torrent system cut the music files vertically, like a loaf of bread. These pieces were downloaded, assembled, and then played from left to right or beginning to end. Since the pieces arrived in random order, they all needed to be in place for the song to begin to play without interruption. Another illustration showed the same music file cut lengthwise, like the layers of a submarine sandwich. It was sliced vertically too, but only four times. That meant that whatever piece of the song arrived first, it was far more likely to contain a part of the first few seconds. Hence, the song could start streaming more quickly. The team tested the theory, which worked in practice. The files were streamed from the servers in the nearby closet, and the music played instantly. With this major challenge solved, the engineers started developing a patchwork of solutions that would ensure that the music kept playing, even when the connection was shaky. The main trick was to load or buffer the song that the user was likely to want to hear next. The very first selection would always be hard to anticipate. But if the user was listening to a playlist, the next song on the list would likely follow. The system, the engineers reasoned, could thus start loading the next few anticipated songs into the computer's cache memory and simply clear it if the user made another selection. After a bit of trial and error, the coders figured that any unexpected selection would have to stream from Spotify's own high-end servers. The peer-to-peer technology was used only for song choices that were easy to predict, such as the next few songs on an album or a playlist. This division of labor also cut costs as the other users' computers helped store and transfer slices of songs. Another trick was to download a user's favorite songs and store them in their own computer's memory. These hacks would ensure a smooth user experience and guard against glitches and delays. Spotify's first protocol became a sort of hybrid. It was a torrent network supported by a central server, bolstered by a bunch of homespun features. It wasn't flawless, but it was close enough. In January 2007, the first demo of Spotify's music player was ready. Everyone who tried it found the experience magical. The engineers could hardly believe what they had accomplished in just a few months. Spotify's client was better than anything else on the current market. It was rocket science for real, an early admirer would express. Daniel was delighted with his engineering team and quickly promoted Frederick Niemöller to the role of Chief Product Officer, CPO. At this point, practically all the songs in Spotify's database were pirated music files from the Pirate Bay and similar websites. The irony escaped no one at the company. Spotify, after all, aimed to be a legal alternative to piracy. But what were they supposed to do? Buy millions of songs on iTunes to fill up the database? Even if they did, the service still wouldn't be legal when the beta version came out. Spotify needed to finish building the product, patent its newly developed technology, and seal licensing deals with the record companies. Then everything would probably work out. With a little luck, Daniel Ek hoped to launch the service in the fall of 2007. Police and Thieves. As Spotify was building its music player, music industry executives were growing increasingly frustrated with all the file sharing in Sweden. Per Sundin, the Nordic head of Sony BMG, would recall how he lost it at a dinner in Stockholm with some newfound acquaintances. "So what you're saying is that you're a family of thieves," the 43-year-old blurted out over the table. He and his wife Jenny were guests at the home of a couple they'd recently gotten to know, and the subject of piracy was about to ruin yet another pleasant evening. Jenny rolled her eyes. She often found herself wishing her husband would shut up about what he did for a living. "Yes, but everyone downloads stuff." "We download. We've stopped buying CDs altogether," the husband on the other side of the table said. Moments like these made Per Sundin's blood boil. He knew that his wife would chastise him when they got home, but he couldn't contain himself. A new flood of accusations came pouring out. How would you feel if your kids shoplifted at the local convenience store? Would that be okay just because it's easy? What do you think artists are supposed to live on? By early 2007, piracy had caused the record industry's revenue to decline for 6 years straight. Nowhere in Europe was the problem worse than in Sweden, where 1.2 of the nation's 9 million people were said to share pirated music files. Per Sundin had already been forced to lay off staff a number of times during the past few years. When his international colleagues within Sony BMG asked him why file sharing was so common in his country, he'd point to several factors. One was the late arrival of iTunes. Apple's music store didn't launch in Sweden until 2005, and by then the nation had already given the world Kazaa, the Pirate Bay, and MicroTorrent. Another reason was Sweden's home PC reform from 1998, a government program that subsidized home computers and spawned all kinds of computer literacy, including hacking and file sharing. Then there were all the incentives that Swedish politicians had provided for the expansion of broadband networks. Most American households could only dream of the high speeds and low prices readily available in Sweden. But it wasn't just the prevalence of piracy that bothered Per Sundin. It was the lax attitude toward the problem, shown by lawmakers and the public alike. For him, the low watermark arrived with the national elections of 2006. A newly formed political party called the Pirate Party was gaining support among young voters. As a result, neither leader of the country's two major political parties was willing to slam file sharing. "We need to make sure that young people who do this downloading don't see themselves as criminals," Prime Minister Göran Persson said in a live television debate a few weeks ahead of the election. Instead of criticizing his opponent, Fredrik Reinfeldt, the leader of the conservative opposition party wavered on the issue. "Are you watching the debate?" Per Sundin's mother said when she called him on the phone. "You need to quit the record industry." Per Sundin would soon leave Sony BMG, but he would remain in the industry. He was about to become the head of Universal Music in Sweden. Soon, a new streaming service called Spotify would pop up on his radar. Save Tonight. In March 2007, a few members of Spotify's engineering team had just pulled another all-nighter at the office. By the early morning, Andreas Ayen, Frederick Niemela, and a developer named Matthias de Zielinski had put together the music player's back and front ends, thus giving birth to the service. When it was time to register the first account, Andreas and Frederick exchanged glances. After a tense moment, Frederick conceded to the man who had recruited him. CTO goes before product, the CPO said. Andreas would recall that indeed he registered Spotify's very first account. Soon the team would create more, selectively distributing beta invites among their friends. These soon sought-after invites were even said to be sold for money on the KTH campus. Sophia Bentz, the now head of information and marketing at Spotify, who had been recruited from the PR firm Prime, was in charge of generating hype in the right circles. Ludwig Strigius and Rasmus Andersson had built a sleek client. Spotify's beta users could search for music and create playlists. There were separate pages for artists and albums and links between the two. And, most importantly, the music began streaming immediately. It felt like pressing play on a locally stored file in iTunes. In the Spotify client, encrypted files were temporarily saved in the cache memory on the user's computer. The decryption key wasn't saved on the hard disk, but in the cloud. Users gained access to the music, but they didn't own it. The age of music streaming was born. Daniel Ek was amazed by the progress, but he was also plagued by a guilty conscience. He was one of few people at Spotify who knew how poorly the negotiations with the record labels and music publishers were going. Still, after paying a lump sum to Sweden's performance rights organization, STIM, he was able to secure test licenses for a limited beta release. Spotify's beta version hit the market in April 2007. To mark the occasion, the team gathered for a group photo. In it, 14 nerdy-looking young men are seen smiling into the camera. Developer Gunnar Kreitz is wearing a black t-shirt with KTH's logo on the chest. Next to him stands Andreas Ayen, in one of his neatly pressed shirts. Further back stands Jonathan Forster, the only one to wear a suit jacket. Daniel Ek's friend from high school, Martin Birkeld, tasked with administrative duties around the office, looks over the shoulder of the lanky Frederick Niemela, who is sporting his goatee and wearing his long hair pulled back. Crouching in the front row is the designer Rasmus Andersson, dressed in a blue and white striped shirt. Spotify's 24-year-old co-founder Daniel Ek is crouched in the very front, dressed in a blue polo shirt with tousled hair and a bald spot. The young chief executive is grinning. His co-founder, Martin Lorentzen, is not in the picture. Invisible Touch. Per-Jorgen Persson stared into the glow of the laptop computer. To him, the music player looked like a dark gray version of iTunes. But when he typed his favorite band, Killswitch Engage, and pressed play, the song started immediately without the slightest delay. It didn't seem to download or buffer. It was just there. On the other side of the table sat Martin Lorentzen, smiling wryly. Per-Jorgen Persson had once been his boss at the venture capital firm Cell Ventures. That firm no longer existed, but Per-Jorgen was now a partner at the venture capital firm North Zone, with offices in one of the five high-rises near the Hertorget Square in central Stockholm. Martin had come there to dazzle him and had clearly succeeded. "Where do the songs come from?" Per-Jorgen asked. Martin showed him that the computer was connected to the internet through his cell phone. Per-Jorgen was taken aback. Over the years, he'd seen hundreds of investors burn their fingers on tech companies promising to reshape the music industry. But what he had in front of him could turn into something truly great, he thought. 8 years ago, Per-Jorgen had missed his chance to invest in Martin's ad tech company, Trade Doubler. He didn't want to make the same mistake again. Spotify, he thought, could be the biggest thing to come out of Sweden since Skype. The seasoned investor did his best to maintain his poker face. He didn't want to seem too interested. He knew that negotiating with Martin wasn't going to be easy since he was already so goddamn rich. Finally, the North Zone partner hinted that he would consider investing in Spotify. But Martin didn't want to state the terms quite yet. He just smiled and said he'd get back in touch. Chapter 3. Rågsved. Daniel Ek grew up in Rågsved, one of Stockholm's first concrete suburbs situated along the subway's green line going south. His father was out of the picture early on. Before Daniel was born, the elder Ek had chosen to live with another woman he was seeing. Daniel had a half-sister who was only 3 months younger than him, and another two half-siblings on his father's side. There seems to have been very little, if any, interaction between the two families. Later in life, Daniel would describe how he and his father were barely in touch. Daniel was raised by his mother, Elisabeth. Early on, he learned how to keep himself occupied. Eventually, Elisabeth met her new husband, Hasse, who became Daniel's stepdad. When Daniel was 10 years old, Hasse and Elisabeth had a child together, Daniel's half-brother, Felix. Elisabeth worked at an after-school center just across the park from their three-story apartment building. Next door was Daniel's grade school, Snursatra Skolan. The family didn't have much money, but Daniel would describe his childhood as happy and full of music. Elisabeth listened to the Bee Gees, Diana Ross, and the Swedish singer-songwriter Ted Gärdestad. At an early age, Daniel learned how to play the family's Spanish guitar with nylon strings. He played children's songs to start, but gradually advanced to music by the Beatles and Nirvana. In school, he took music lessons and learned to play drums, bass, piano, and the accordion. As a teenager, he played in a couple of local bands and took lead roles in school musicals. While an avid musician, Daniel was a computer virtuoso. He received his first computer, an old Commodore VIC-20, which hooked up to the television as a 5-year-old. It would soon be replaced by a Commodore 64, complete with games that kept him occupied for hours every day. Early on, when he had trouble loading one of the games from the external tape deck, he asked his mother for help. "You'll have to solve that for yourself," she said, as Daniel would recall. Eventually, Daniel's stepdad gave him a PC. He started coding at the age of 9. By the age of 11, he was imagining a career in technology and telling people that he was going to be bigger than Bill Gates. Below the hill, a short walk from the family's apartment, lay Rågsved city center. Next to it was the local youth center with a facade covered in a renowned 1989 graffiti mural. It had a gym and rehearsal space, and local kids would play table tennis and floorball there. Daniel Ek was often seen there in his early teens. Mika Johansson, a staff member, would remember Daniel as a kind and well-behaved kid. He recalled how Daniel would often arrive on his own and sometimes practice bass guitar. Daniel was reserved, at least compared to his mother. Elisabeth was more of a straight talker, one of few parents that really got involved in the youth club's activities. Center manager Rikard Ricky Klemming, a man in his 60s, ran a tight ship and was fond of involving the local talent. When he needed to install computers with fast internet connections, he turned to Daniel, who had earned a reputation as a computer whiz. In a show of initiative and salesmanship, Daniel rose to the occasion and secured what he would describe as his first professional gig. He had overpromised and needed the support of his stepdad to get the job done, but they managed to do it. It felt good. Daniel Ek was on his way to becoming Rågsved's youngest IT consultant. Staten och kapitalet. When Roegsved was built at the end of the 1950s, the suburb was considered a wonder of modernism, with its towering apartment blocks and a central building in the shape of a horseshoe. But just a decade later, the picture changed entirely. Roegsved was suddenly described as a problem area associated with drugs and alienated youth. Toward the end of the 1970s, the Swedish punk band Ebba Grön put the area on the map. In just a few years, the band's brooding lead singer, Joachim Toström, became a national sensation. The band played to packed houses at Oasen, the local club next to the youth center. Punk rockers from all over Stockholm came there to see Ebba Grön, and suddenly Roegsved, or Rogan as it was called, became the heart of the whole punk rock movement in Sweden. The music united a generation that wanted to rebel with the clamor of Ebba Grön's politically charged hit, Staten och kapitalet, the state and the capital, as their anthem. When the local politicians announced that Oasen was to be rebuilt, the punk rockers responded by occupying the building. They painted protest signs and barricaded themselves for 10 days until they were dragged out by police. When Daniel Ek was born in February 1983, the local punk scene had all but died out. His generation would rally around another call to arms against authorities trying to silence their music. Instead of punk rock, they were captivated by file sharing, a culture that was deemed illegal and would spawn its own political movement. School days. In 1996, Daniel Ek started middle school in Roegsvedskolan, a short walk from the youth center. It had already earned a reputation as a rowdy school. Former students would describe how some kids fought, took drugs, and drank on the weekends. But for most,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.